go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. In almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. In almighty fortress, you go before.
Stand with me. Let's get ready to worship. We made it to Thursday. We're going to do some worship here in just a second. Pastor Jonathan's bringing the word today. We're also going to be doing communion today, a love communion. We're in the third week of Flip the Script. Pastor Jonathan's going to be talking about Jonah at the well today. I think you're going to enjoy it. But before we do that, we're going to get into some worship here in just a second. And we're going to see what the Lord's going to do. And I believe he's going to do some great things today, right here, right now. So if you would, let's get ready. And let's go ahead and give God a hand clap of praise right quick. Amen. 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 Welcome. My name is Shane. I'm the campus pastor here at this location. We're honored that you came out to worship with us today. If you're new to Life Springs Church, if you would scan that QR code that's in the seat back in front of you. We've got a gift for you. We'd like to connect with you. And then after the service, out in the lobby, we have our guest services area. We want to give you a gift before you get off the property. But enough about that. We're going to get into some worship. I don't know about y'all, but I've been ready for worship all week long. And we're ready. We're getting ready to get some of that here in just a second. So who's ready to worship? Okay, there's a few of you. All right, well, let's pray and we'll get right into it. Father, we praise you and we thank you, God, for your goodness. We thank you, God, for your word is truth. We thank you, God, that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are the anchor that holds us tight. You are merciful. You are great. You are mighty. You are a good God. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. And today, as we go into worship, I pray, Father, that we would tune out all distractions, everything, that we would take all that stuff out of our minds and put the focus on you. So, Father, we love you and we praise you. We give you all the glory. We ask in Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Let's worship.
I can describe it, but I can't contain it. I can't keep it to myself. There aren't enough colors to paint the whole picture. Not enough words to ever say what I find. One. That's my shepherd, my protector. That's my king. That's my rock. That's my anchor, my defense. Today. Amen.
The same that roll of the grave. There's no power.
was born to lift your name above all names. You hear the melody of all creation. But there's a song of praise that only I can bring. Who else is worthy? Who else is worthy? There is no one, only you, Jesus. Who else is worthy? Who else is worthy? There is no one, only you, Jesus. You are the infinite God of the ages. Yet you chose to make my heart a dwelling place. You healed my brokenness, showed me your glory. So I have songs of thanks not even angels sing. Who else is worthy? Who else is worthy? There is no
yep. and you know that we have a healer, a redeemer. Come on, you can do better than that. Come on and clap your hands and give God praise in this place. Come on and give God praise in this place. Everything bows at his name. Somebody say everything. I can hear you say everything. Hey, at this time, I'm Pastor Daniel Owens, the outreach pastor. And listen, if you can get your communion elements, it's either in front of you or behind the chair. I want everybody to get your communion elements in your hand, because everything bow at his name. Everything bow at his name. Because Jesus is my healer. Listen, if you're watching online, stop it right now. Go and get some elements, whether it's juice, whether it's crackers, whatever it may be, as the representation of Jesus' blood and his body. Somebody shout everything. Everything bow at his name. He is our healer. As I was going through and preparing for this moment in time, I was went through and I was looking in the Bible when that was talking about Jesus in the Bible and how that he sacrificed and he was going to be the ultimate atonement and he was going to be the ultimate of our sins. And I found out it was in the past, the present, and the future. In Isaiah 53, the prophet Isaiah speaks of the Messiah that's coming. In Matthew's and the Synoptic Gospel, Jesus himself says, take, eat, this is my body, drink, this is my blood, and remember this in remembrance of me. And then Paul writes in the Acts of the Apostles, and he teaches the different churches how to take communion, and I always do this in remembrance of him. But why is Jesus? I'm glad you asked. Paul says it hundreds of years before Jesus show up on the scene. It says in Isaiah 53, it says, surely he took our pains and bore our sins. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we was healed. Jesus is our healer. You say, our healer, we always think of sickness, or we always think of a broken bone or something of that matter, but healness means to bring back whole again. And if you check the record in your life, Jesus has healed a lot of things in your life. He's healed your family, brought it back to whole again. He's healed your finances, brought it back to whole again. He's healed your child, brought her back to whole again. Because Jesus is our healer. And for that, we have to remember what he's done for us. But the ultimate healing that he done was for our sin, sick soul, our sickness of sin, that only one blood, only one body can save us from the sins that we have committed. And that is Jesus Christ. He is our healer. And so at this time, as we remember this, let us take our communion elements, and if you could just slide a piece of that top off right there, that helps. Take out that wafer there. This represents his body. The Bible says he was abused for our iniquities, for our wickedness, for our sin. This lets us know that sin has a price. But I'm so glad that Jesus paid the price for us on Calvary. And because he paid the price for us, we now have access to the kingdom of God forever and ever and ever and ever. At this time, take this, eat. This is my body. So old hymn says, what can wash away your sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. They said Clorox can wash stains out of clothes. Yes, it can. But only Jesus' blood can wash your sins whiter than snow. And it's because his blood was pierced on Calvary. It was the resolution to our sins to be forgotten and remember no more. Take, drink, this is my blood. Now, Father, we thank you now for your son you sent to die for our sins. Thank you, God, that when he was sitting there on that cross, he didn't murmur nor complain. But God, he He did your will and not his will. Thank you. And God, we will never forget what your son has done for us. And so that's why we call him healer. That's why we call him redeemer. And that's why we can get peace from what he's done for us. And now, God, we thank you right now that this representation, that anybody that's sick among us, I pray that you heal their body right now. God, give them peace that passes all understanding. Mend their broken hearts together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, come on, let's get ready to sing this. I really want you to sing it like you want it, that everything bow has his name, because Jesus is our healer. Come on. Come on, sing it.
Everything bows in his name.
Come on, tell him everything. Come on, sing it like you really mean it. That you are God. Thank you, God, that you didn't forget about us. And everything that we do, God, help us to do it in your will and not our will. Help us to understand that sin comes with a price. And God, we don't take it for granted that you sent your only begotten son to die for our sins. Father, we thank you for the individual that's watching from jail. Thank you for the individual that's watching in rehab, whatever it may be. Meet them where they are. Because just like you can save our lives, you can save theirs as well. Because Jesus changes everything. Now, God, be with us in this service. As Pastor Jonathan come and bring this rhema word that you have given him in his heart. I pray, God, that we open up our ears and our spirit, man, to receive what you have for us. And leave out of here different than we came. In Jesus' name. And everybody said. And everybody said. And everybody said. Clap your hands and give God praise in this place. Whew. And you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hey, I just want to let you know, hey, thank you. If this is your first time here, make sure you scan the back of the barcode of the seat. We have a free gift for you in our guest services area. But we'd like to let you know we are recording live here. And this recording is not only going just on the internet, but it's going into 96 jails across the East Coast and reaching 13,000 inmates a day. So we want to make sure that it can hear this word loud and clear. So we have created different opportunities that if you have, so we like to keep this area a little quieter and stiller. So if we can make sure we do that, we do have different other atmospheres. If you don't want to take advantage of our wonderful kids ministry yet, we have the party room outside to the right, or you can also go to the lounge as well, because we know that God is getting ready to move in this place. Can I get an amen to that? Can I get an amen to that? Can I get an amen to that? All right, come on and give God praise one more time and pay attention to the monitors.
Hey everybody, whether you are at any of our locations or watching online, we are so glad that you have joined us today. Welcome home. If you are attending the Sanford location, scan the QR code to get access to the internet.
At Life Springs, we are passionate about helping you discover the love of Jesus, develop the character of Jesus, and deliver the message of Jesus. There are many ways we seek to accomplish this goal, so let's take a look at some of the places to start.
It all begins by connecting with people. God designed us for a relationship with Him and each other. We have a lot of opportunities for you to get connected. Here are just a few. To stay up to date with everything going on, be sure to scan this QR code or go to lifesprings.online.
If you're new here, we did not invite you here to take your money. We just want you to hear the greatest story ever told. In fact, if this is your first time, scan this QR code now, and we have a free gift just for you.
If you are part of our church family and call Life Springs Church your home, now is your opportunity to give. You can either give in person with giving envelopes, online at lifesprings.online, or through our Church Center app.
You want to get involved or learn more about Life Springs Church? Then you should come to Growth Track. Sign up for the next Growth Track by scanning this QR code or go to lifesprings.online.
To stay connected throughout the week, make sure to follow us on social media through Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, and TikTok.
Thank you again for joining us today. As we prepare for today's message, be sure to text sermon or prayer to 833-205-6534 for sermon notes or for prayer. All right, it's time for the message. So put your hands together as we get ready to hear from God's Word.
How's everybody doing today? Come on, let's try a little bit better. How's everyone doing today? How many glad to be at church and not somewhere else? Come on, right? Amen. Yeah, so hey, I'm Jonathan. I'm one of our pastors here, and I want to take a moment and greet those in this auditorium, those in the party room, and those in the lobby. We've got folks tuning in online at Western Harnett, those that are incarcerated. Can we just take a moment and thank God for our whole church family? Amen. Well, hey, I want to get on into this. I've always been told that I'm the short-winded preacher here. Anybody glad about that? Come on, somebody. You want me to preach for an hour? I'll do that too. I mean, come on, right? So, hey, I'm glad to be here. I've got one quick announcement before I get into it. You've heard about this before, but we call it Leadership Nuggets Live. Somebody say Leadership Nuggets Live. I want you to sign up for this. I'm very excited about this. If you were here last weekend, you heard Pastor Dale talk about this. And what's happening is Pastor Dale is going to impart some of his leadership knowledge on us on Saturday, March 9th. Now, you might be thinking, well, I don't lead. This ain't for me. Come on, let me just tell you what this really is for. Raise your hand if you're a group leader here in this auditorium right now. Anybody? Yeah, you're a leader. You need to come. Is there anyone here who teaches kids in our kids ministry in this room right now? Anybody? Okay, yeah, I see one back there. Yeah, you need to come. If you've ever opened your mouth and told somebody hello when they came to church, are you in the room today? Yeah, you need to come. If you've ever wanted to tell someone what to do, you need to come, right? So make sure you take a moment and scan that QR code and sign up, because here's what I've learned. I've become a better man, a better father, a better person because of who God has made as the shepherd of this house. And I encourage you to sit under him and learn a little thing. Can we just thank God for Pastor Dale? Amen. Yeah. Now, he's not with us today because he's doing a lot of recordings for the video devotional that he's been doing, Do the Next Right Thing. He's got a lot of other things, and so he's taking a couple weeks off to do that. And so some of us other folks are getting to preach. And let me just ask you, how many of you enjoyed last week with Pastor Daniel? Amen. Yeah. So I'm excited to be here. Now, y'all shouted him down. Can y'all shout me down a little bit? Let me just hear you real quick. All right, here's what I've learned. The more you shout, the quicker I preach. God bless y'all. See you next week. I'm kidding. I feel like God really has put a word in my heart for today. And so last series we did was called Change. Go ahead and just raise your hand if you enjoyed that series, got something out of that. Yeah, talking about the fear of God and how when you get under the covering of God, boy, it just changes everything, doesn't it? Well, this series, you see it on the screen, is called 1, 2, 3, Flip the... Let's try that one more time. You see it on the screen. 1, 2, 3, it's called... That's right. We want to flip the script. So what we're doing in this series is we're kind of bumping up against last one, and we're talking about people in the Bible who either were out of God's covering and got under it, or were under the covering and got out from under it, right? And so today, I want to talk about somebody who flipped the script. And so the title for my message, if you would, is Didn't See That One Coming. Somebody say that, 1, 2, 3. You ever had a time in your life when you didn't see that coming? Like, for example, how about times when you've been watching a movie and the good guy turns out to be the bad guy, right? I didn't see. Yeah, or maybe you were driving down US 1 and all of a sudden someone merges into your lane. I didn't. Well, maybe you were the one today who merged in front of me on US 1. I didn't see that coming. Blind spots, right? Or maybe you were at work and you had a regular, ordinary day and you get up and you went to McDonald's to get yourself one of those Egg McMuffins and a little bit of an iced caramel macchiato and you excited about work today and you get there and you find out layoffs. I didn't what? I didn't. Or you go home, and you think you're going to an ordinary day with your spouse and kids, and you find out your wife ain't there because she done left you. I didn't what? I didn't. You ever had a time in your life when I didn't see that coming? Come on, somebody, right? It happens all the time. And I want to tell you about a story in my life when I didn't see that coming. Years ago, I think I was in eighth grade. Anybody remember being in eighth grade? Can I just tell you? I thank God I am not in eighth grade no more. Middle school days was awkward. Come on, somebody. I mean, your hormones are changing, your body's changing. You don't even know what to do with yourself, right? Well, I was eighth grade, and I was, not as cool as I am today. And my mama, she didn't shop like she does today, because nowadays I think she has more money than she did when I was in eighth grade. In fact, you know how Pastor Dale says he gets his shirts from Manhattan? If a man hadn't have given it to him, my mama shopped at the same place. I mean, you know what I'm saying, right? And so one day, I got up late. I didn't see it coming. The alarm kept on snoozing. You know what I'm talking about. And so I got up late, and I was in a hurry to get to the bus. And so I just threw on the first thing that I saw without even thinking. And let me tell you what it was. Purple sweatpants and a Carolina Panthers black t-shirt. The one Panthers fan in the room. Now just think about this for a second. Awkward Jonathan Carter, same size as I am right now in eighth grade, wearing purple sweatpants and a black Carolina Panthers t-shirt. I promise I wasn't the most popular. And on that particular day at recess, I was about to say recess, Lord, I'm in fourth grade again, right? At gym class, we were going to run track. Now, when you look at my physique, this ain't a runner's kind of body, right? Now, on that day, we were going to run a relay. Now, if you don't know what a relay is, this is when you got a team of four, and you're going to pass that baton from one to the next at a certain leg of the run, and you're running as a team to see which team can get across first, right? Well, I thought, here's what I'm going to do. My high school and middle school career, what I wanted to do was not try to be super popular and not try to be the loser. I just want to be in the middle. So what I thought I would do is wait to see who else gets picked, because probably some losers would get picked and I'd be cooler than them. Y'all track it with me? And so when I get to the line and they're starting to pick, everybody gets picked except for the track team. And so it's me and the three fastest guys on the track team. Now, I look at them, I look at me, I look at them, I look at me and say, I didn't see that coming. Because now I got to run with these other guys. Let me ask you, you ever had a time when you didn't see that coming? When something happens in your life that changes everything? Well, today we're going to look at the story of a guy named Jonah. Somebody say Jonah. Now, you probably have heard of the story of Jonah. Would you raise your hand if you've ever heard of Jonah? Yeah. You know, he's one of those popular guys that you hear about in all the storybooks, right? Jonah and the big what? Whale, right? And so Jonah was told to go one direction and disobeyed God and goes the other. So God sends a storm. The people throw him out of the boat and a big old fish swallows him, right? That's the story. Well, can I just tell you, I think God flipped the script, and I bet you he didn't see that coming. So I want to look at that today, but before I do, this is your Life Springs Church social media moment. Here's what it says. It says, get on board with God's plan. It's the best plan anyway. Anybody believe that? So say amen. I want you to take a picture of that and post it on SnapNeck or Facelift or Tic-Tac-Toe, whatever you got, because I want the world to know that God's plan is what? It is the best. That's right. So as we go through today, the life of Jonah, you're going to see some things that you've already known. In fact, I don't want you to just glaze over because you've heard this story, okay? Because I promise you, I'm going to pull some things out you've probably never seen before. I want you to lean in because I want to highlight a part of Jonah's story and then give you some lessons to learn from in his life. So if you're ready, say ready. Now, as we go through this, I'm probably going to stop here and there. And I was raised Pentecostal. Can I get a little Pentecostal tonight? Pastor Shane, can I get a little Pentecostal? Just a little? Just a little. All right, I'll put my hands in my pockets then. John 1, verse 1, here's what it says. The Lord gave this message to Jonah, son of Amittai. Read that highlighted part with me, if you would. 1, 2, 3, get up and... He said what? He said, get up and go. You know, it kind of reminds me around here, we say God saved us, and then he what? He, get up and go to the great city of Nineveh. Announce my judgment against it, because I have seen how wicked its people are. But Jonah got up, and what did he do? Read it, 1, 2, 3. He went in the opposite direction. God said, go this way. But Jonah's going where? That way. He's going the opposite direction to get away from the Lord. He went down. Someone say he went down. He went down to the port of Joppa, where he found a ship leaving for Tarshish. He bought a ticket. Went on board, hoping to escape from the Lord, sailing to Tarshish. Now, I want to stop right there, because I believe there's a lot of things that we could learn from him. In fact, I want to go deep diving. Get it? Boat, deep. All right, moving on. God had some things he wanted to do in Nineveh. And who did he call to work in Nineveh? What was his name? Say it one more time. 1, 2, 3. Jonah. Jonah has been given an incredible task. Jonah, a prophet, if you will, an evangelist, if you will, has been told by God, I want you to go to one of the most wicked cities and preach my judgment upon that city. Now, when you think about it, there's not a lot of cities that God wanted to destroy. I can think of just a few. Sodom. Anybody know the other one? Gomorrah, right? At the beginning, he wanted to destroy the world except for Noah and his family. And now God's going to do some judgment on Nineveh. See, if you know anything about preaching, most preachers would love an opportunity like this because it's low-hanging fruit. When you go somewhere and people are hurting, you can preach the gospel and it changes everything. And so Jonah, he gets this opportunity, but he says, I don't want it. Let me just ask you. Have you ever stopped to think, why did God ask Jonah to do this? You want me to tell you why? Because God knew that when Jonah went, he would be successful. Can I just tell you something? God's never going to call you to do something that he doesn't know you're already going to win. If he's called you to something, you can go ahead and rest assured it's going to be okay. You're going to win because God called you to it. He'll take care of it. Don't you be afraid. Just keep going. He called him to it. He said, I'm telling you, you are going to win. But Jonah don't want to go. He goes down. Someone say down. He goes down to Joppa and chooses to go the opposite direction. Can I just tell you something? When you choose to not get on the boat, when you choose to not follow God's plan, you know what happens to you? It will always take you down. If you don't trust God when he says, I'm calling you to this, when you run from God, it'll take you down further than places than you ever thought, dreamt, or imagined. He goes down. In fact, I learned that Joppa, where he was only 500 miles away from Nineveh. Think about it, 500 miles away. But where he wanted to go was Tarshish. Did you know that Tarshish is 2,500 miles away? He wants to go as far from God as he can. But you know what I've learned? Sometimes we work harder to disobey God when if we would just listen, it'd be a lot easier. For example, think about it. We'll come up with excuses on why we can't tell someone about our faith. We'll come up with excuses about why we can't invite somebody to church. We'll come up with excuses about why we can't step up in leadership or go to this leadership learning thing from Pastor Dale, or why we can't start that business or go to that school or marry that right person or wait before marriage, because we say it'd be a lot easier when God says it's a lot harder. We've got to step up and listen. He went down to Joppa running from God. But let me tell you what else he did. When he got there to the port city of Joppa, he bought a ticket. Right? Somebody say, I bought a ticket. He bought a ticket. He didn't just run. He paid money to run from God. Can I tell you something? When you're running from God, it's going to cost you something. When you decide to run from God, it's going to cost you something. It might cost you your peace. It might cost you your future. It might cost you your family. It might cost you your health. When you say, I'm going to run from God, it's going to cost you. Somebody say, I didn't see that coming. Jonah is running from God. Now, I've already been preaching for about 10, 15 minutes, and we've only gone through three verses. And I'm going through four chapters today. I'm going to have to speed up. Come on, am I right? And so I want to highlight for a second a few things that happen in the story of Jonah. So now Jonah, he's in Joppa. He's bought a ticket to get on the boat to go to Tarshish. He gets on that boat. And what does God do? He sends a huge storm that starts breaking the boat apart. In other words, God is about to flip the script. God is about to do something else. And so the other men that are on the boat, they're terrified, they're scared, and they realize that this storm is not an ordinary storm. It feels like something more powerful is behind this storm. This ain't just Katrina. This ain't just Ivan. This is something more powerful. They realize there must be a God that is working in this storm. And they start to say to each other, now somebody just pray to any God that'll listen. Because they want this storm to calm. Well, guess what happens? Jonah, he's in the bottom of the boat sleeping. He's sleeping while God's moving. I think there's a sermon there, somebody. Sometimes we'll be sleeping when God is moving. I don't know if you've been paying attention around here, but it feels like God has been moving at Life Springs Church, and some of you have been sleeping. He's doing incredible things in the Dream Center. He's doing incredible things with our teenagers. We're seeing salvations like crazy. 892 people last year. God is on the move. Be careful that you're not sleeping when God's moving. So these guys, they wake up Jonah, and they heard his story, how God wanted him to go to Nineveh. And so they look at him, and they start to ask him different questions to figure out who you are, what's going on, who's the God that is against this. And Jonah explains it all. You need to look at it, chapter 1. And here's what they say to Jonah. Listen, why did you do it? Just let that sink in for a second. These people who don't know God look at the man of God and say, why did you do it? Why did you run from God? Can you imagine what it would feel like for someone who doesn't even believe in God to look at a Christian and say, why did you do it? You ever done something in your life that you regret, even as a Christian? Better be careful. People are watching. Why'd you do it? Why did you run? Why did you shrink back? Why did you go back to that bottle? Why did you quit believing in God? Why'd you stop going to church? Why did you do it? See, I'm here to tell you, when God wants you on his side, he is relentless to bring you back onto his boat. He wants to bring you back where he is. And so these sailors, they ask him, well, what do we do next? And you know what Jonah says? He says, throw me overboard, and that'll stop the problem. See, I got to thinking about this, and you'll see it later in chapter 4. But Jonah, I think he's struggling mentally. He's got some things going on in his mind. And this was a thing that he wanted to see happen. I wonder if he wasn't having suicidal thoughts. Said, just get rid of me. I want to be done with this world. He says, throw me overboard. But you know what I've also learned? When someone is running from God, they'll take the whole boat down with them. If you are running from God, be careful. Everyone around you is going to fail. When you put someone on your boat who is running from God, they will take you down. Some of you, you're dating somebody who's not even a Christian, and you think, well, I'll be able to fix them. Can I just tell you, it's a whole lot easier to pull someone down than to lift somebody up. You got to be careful who you put in your boat. Some of you, you've had friends from college that every time you get around them, you do things that you regret. It's time to get rid of some friends. It's time to delete some Facebook friends or go through your phone and remove some people. Be careful who you put on your boat, because it will mess you up. One of the sailors decided, okay, we're going to throw him over. But these sailors started to pray to the God of Jonah. And they said, God, please don't hurt us on his behalf. Please spare us. And that's what God did. And so when that happened, Jonah finds himself now in the water, and God sends a big old fish to swallow him up. Now, for many of us, that's where the storybook ended. But let me just tell you, there's a whole lot more to the story of Jonah. I want to show you four lessons from the life of Jonah in the last little bit of time I've got to help you see how you can flip the script. So if you're ready, say ready. Here's number one, lessons from the life of Jonah. God's plans are inescapable. Somebody say, God's plans are inescapable. Jonah thought he could run, didn't he? He thought, I'm going to get to Joppa, I'm going to buy me a ticket, I'm going to go to Tarshish, and God's going to leave me alone. Can I just tell you, God won't leave you alone. God loves you too much. We've heard the story, we've sung the song before, where he says he'll leave the 99 to find the one. He will do whatever he has to find that lost person. God is relentless in doing that. You know what I've learned? God will either do it through you or he'll do it in spite of you. But whatever God wants to see happen will happen. You can take it to the bank. God's plans are inescapable, and you can run, but you can't hide. He's going to do what he wants to do. Look what it says right here in Jonah chapter 1, verse 17. It says, now the Lord had what? The Lord had arranged. Somebody say arranged. The Lord had arranged for a great fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was inside of the fish for 3 days, and for how long? Three nights. Somebody say, I didn't see that coming. Usually, when you jump into the water, something's going to kill you, right? Years ago, my wife and her family, they loved to go snorkeling. Any snorkeling fans in the house? A few of you? All right. My wife and I, we'd been married for a few months. We go off to the Virgin Islands with her parents. Here's what happened. They wanted to pay for the trip, so I told the Lord, thank you. But I'd never been snorkeling. So we go to the U.S. Virgin Islands, and they said, Jonathan, we're going to get you this snorkeling kit, and it's so much fun. You're going to love it. You're going to get to float in the water. You're going to get to see all kinds of things from God's creation. It's going to be awesome. So I get my mask. They didn't tell me nothing. They went just floating. I put this mask on. I put my face in the water, and I kept sucking in water. Okay, this ain't for me, right? I take these shoes. I put them right on. It won't work. They didn't tell me that there's an insert you got to take out of the shoe. And then they played a trick on me and gave me a mask with a hole in it. I know I married their daughter, but killing me is not right. So I get into this water with a new mask and I start floating. And we did this for about 6 days, different beaches in the Virgin Islands. Every single day that we went, there was something trying to kill your boy, JC. It was a sea urchin, a stingray, a barracuda. One day we even saw a shark. Who in the world wants to go snorkeling? When Jonah gets into that water, he ain't thinking a big old fish is going to swallow me and I'm going to be okay. In other words, he was saying, I didn't see what? I didn't see that coming. But you know what I love about this? Those first four words. Five. Math is hard. Now the Lord had what? Arranged. He arranged for that great fish to swallow Jonah. In other words, I don't know how he did it. God might have made a fish right there that could do it. I don't know if God called him. Like, for example, anyone ever seen the movie Finding Dory? You remember that thing some whales do called echolocation? I don't know if God said, swallow Jonah. I don't know how he did it, but somehow God arranged it. Can I just tell you, God's been arranging your life everywhere you've been. He's been arranging your path. He's been arranging the people. He's been arranging the situations. You thought God was against you, but I'm here to tell you, He is for you. He's been arranging it all. That's what He does. And here's the thing I want you to see. Who did it? It's the third word. One, two, three, the Lord. Did you know that God will get personally involved in rescuing you? He did it for Jonah. He does it for you. That's why He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross for your sins. He is personally involved with your rescue. He loves you too much. See, the God of the universe, He gets involved in rescuing Jonah. And God's going to keep rescuing you. He loves you too much. Jonah, he's now in the belly of that whale or that big fish. It doesn't say whale, but that's what we think it is some days. He gets some time on his hands to cipher. 3 days in the day and night in darkness. I mean, come on. It ain't like the Motel 6. They didn't keep the light on. It's dark. They ain't no calamari. Well, maybe there is, but it won't cook for him. It won't ready for him, right? He ain't got nothing. He ain't got no cell phone reception. What's he going to do? He just spends his time praying. Which brings me to number two. A lesson from the life of Jonah. God's blessings are immeasurable. God's blessings are what? They are immeasurable. Before I even look at it, just a show of hands. How many of you, if you would be honest with yourself, you'd say God has blessed you? You may not have everything that you want, but you got everything you need, don't you? You may not have always the things that you wish you had, but you got some stuff that you would like to have. You've got health, you've got life, you've got shelter, you've got food. Some of us have more of it than others, but you're blessed. Jonah, while he's in that whale or that big old fish, he prays to God, and look what he says. Then Jonah pray to the Lord, his God, from inside the fish. He said, 1, 2, 3, I cried out to the Lord in my great trouble. And he what? He. You ever heard that song? I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he what? He. That's why I what? That's why I trust him. Jonah sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. Then down to verse 9, Jonah says this. All of chapter 2 is just one big prayer. But I will offer sacrifices to you with song of praise, and I will fulfill all my vows. For read that next part. 1, 2, 3. For my salvation. Then the Lord ordered, verse 10, the fish to spit Jonah out onto the beach. You know what I've learned? Jonah was in the whale. He didn't know what was going to happen. He didn't know if he was going to get consumed, if he'd ever see the light of day. But what did he do? He still kept praying. He didn't know what was going to happen next, but he still kept praising. In other words, praise precedes the blessings. Some of you, you sitting in darkness, you sitting in the belly of a whale, you've been asking God for something and it doesn't seem like he's been answering, but I'm here to tell you, you keep praying, you keep praising, because there's going to come a day where God's going to show up and the thing you've been praying for is going to come to pass. You feel like there's a glass ceiling and you're praying and you can see them, but you don't think God's answering, but one day your prayers are going to make you stronger and you're going to jump a little higher and you're going to believe God something. And that glass ceiling's going to break through and God's going to show up. You keep praising because God's going to show up. His blessings are immeasurable. Somebody say, I didn't see that coming. I don't know what he was thinking, but God showed up. It reminds me of times in your life and in mine when you get a good doctor's report and you didn't even ask for it. Or times when you were crying out to God, praying for something, and he showed up for you. Times when you were told that you were broke as a joke, but God blessed your bank account anyway. Times where you were struggling, but God showed up in the midst of it all. God's blessings are what? They're immeasurable. Here's number 3. Lessons from the life of Jonah. God's word is unstoppable. Can I just ask a question? You may not want to raise your hand, but how many of you read your Bible every day? Amen. I want you to think for a second. If you were in the hospital and the doctor had a medication that they could give you that would make your life better, wouldn't you take it? Did you know that God gave you a prescription that can change your life and is called the Word of God? Everything you've ever needed is in His Word. If you've got a question, He's got an answer. If you've got a problem, He's got a solution. If you've got a fear, He's got joy. Whatever you need, He's got it in His Word. Jonah was on a mission from God. He was supposed to go to Nineveh and announce God's soon coming judgment on their wickedness. Just think about that for a second. That would not be a popular message, would it? If I went to Depot Park right here in Sanford tomorrow and I started preaching the message that Jonah preached to Nineveh, they would not like it, would they? But Jonah begins to open his mouth in Jonah chapter 3, verse 4, and here's what he says. On the day Jonah entered the city, he shouted. Someone say shouted. Shouted to the crowds. Read this next part with me. 1, 2, 3. 40 days from now. Whoo. Shortest message ever. 8 words. In Hebrew, it's only 5. Now, I don't know what Jonah was expecting, but when he said those words, something changed. God flipped the script in Nineveh. Can I just tell you, if you'll get into God's Word, He wants to flip the script in your life. There's some powerful messages in God's Word. I want to show you a few of them. Isaiah 41, verse 10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Romans 8:28, and we know that God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purposes. I could go on and on. Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. You want some more? Matthew 6:33 says this. It says, for you to make sure that you put his kingdom first, and then everything you need, he'll give you. I could say one after the other after the other. Isaiah 54:17 says, no weapon formed against me will prosper. Anytime you got a problem, God's got the answer. You just need to open his word. It's no wonder what happened to Nineveh after Jonah said those 8 little words. God flipped the script in Nineveh. Look at it here in verse 5. The people of Nineveh believed God's message. And from the greatest to the least, they declared a fast and put on burlap to show their sorrow. When the king of Nineveh heard what Jonah was saying, read that highlighted part, 1, 2, 3, he stepped down from his throne. Just stop right there. Just stop right there. The king of Nineveh hears the word of God, and what does he do? He gets off of his throne. Sometimes I want to say to the church, especially in America, get off your throne and get into God's word. You think it's all about you? It's not. It was never about you. It's always been about him. We've got to get off the throne and put on regular clothes and say, I'm just a regular person. Thank you, God, for what you've done for me. He gets off the throne. He takes off his royal robes. He dressed himself in burlap and sat on a heap of ashes. Even the king gets in on this salvation. Even the highest of the high to the lowest of the low. And I don't have time to read it, but verse 10, God chooses to not destroy the city. I just want to tell you, there's power in the word of God. That's why it's called a living word. You ever open that book and something just seems to jump off the pages when you didn't even imagine it? It might even be the verse of the day from the Bible app. Or you might open up that Bible and you start to read and just bam, something just pops off because it's power in the word of God. How you feeling so far? Good? I'm about to make it worse. Put those first ones on the screen if you don't mind. Let's go to number 4. God's plans are what? They are. God's blessings are what? God's word is what? God's mercy is? Come on, let's just thank God for that. His mercy is undeniable. Now, before I get into point number 4, let me just go ahead and ask you. I've told you a lot about Jonah's story. And be honest with yourself. Let's take a poll. We don't vote here at Life Springs Church, but let's take a poll. How many of you wish you could be like Jonah? Okay, not any of you. I don't know about you, but I wish that when I spoke, lives were changed. Anybody else? I wish that when I spoke the word of God, it just radically just changed everything. Jonah seems to be a hero. In fact, growing up as a kid, reading the storybooks, he was the hero. This guy who ran from God, he falls into the water, a fish comes and swallows him up, he changes his ways, he preaches the gospel, and a whole city turns around. That's incredible, ain't it? But you know what's interesting? Most preachers, most storybooks don't tell you chapter 4. But I want to, because I really feel like this is the message for the church in America. This is the message that might be for you watching online. See, this is where the script really gets flipped. This is when everything you thought about Jonah is about to change. This man who ran from God, who then turns back and he comes to share the gospel. Look what happens. The people of Nineveh have turned from their wicked ways. God has spared the city. And then verse 1, look what it says. This change of plans, read that next part, 1, 2, 3, greatly upset Jonah. And he became what? Stop and think about that for a second. Jonah, the man of God, who shows up on the scene, who goes into the city, who uses 8 words to turn the city around. He says, repent. He says, judgment's coming. And he is now upset. Who is he upset at? God? What's he said about? Nineveh being spared? Hold up. I thought he came to preach repentance. Or did he? He didn't preach repentance. What did he preach? Judgment. Let that sink in for a second. Jonah, the man of God, comes to preach, and he doesn't preach repentance. What does he preach? He preaches judgment. Verse 2. So he complained to the Lord about it. Didn't I say before I left home that you would do this, Lord? That's why I ran away to Tarshish. I want to stop there. Growing up as a kid, I thought Jonah ran away from God and his mission because he was afraid. He's not afraid. He is mad. He doesn't want God to spare the city. What in the world? Here's what he says. I knew. Someone say, I knew. I knew that you are merciful and a compassionate God, slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love. You are eager to turn back from destroying people. Do y'all feel the weight of this? Jonah didn't run because he was scared they would kill him when he got there. Jonah ran because he was scared God would spare them. In other words, Jonah wants to play God as to who receives his mercy. Just think about it. Jonah, a Hebrew man who's been supposed to share the message of God, doesn't want to because he's afraid it'll work, that God will spare people. I don't think Jonah had an obedience issue. I think he had a heart issue. This man who I used to think was a hero of the faith, he ain't a hero now. In fact, let me ask you, take a poll again. Anybody want to be Jonah now? No. Jonah, in chapter 1, ran because he knew who God was. Let me just tell you, I didn't see that coming. See, I want to stop there for a second. I feel like Jonah chapter 4 is a message for somebody here today. You love God. Come to church every week. But if you were Jonah, your message might be judgment too. Let me give you some examples. I'm sure some of you love that we got a dream center. But if you're honest with yourself, you'll never step foot in there to serve because you don't want to serve the people the Dream Center serves. For some of you, boy, you love God and we sing, I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. But then when you get real with it, you really don't want to help somebody because you got prejudice in your heart. For some of you, you were raised one way and the world's trying to tell you it ain't right and it's called racism. Let me just tell you, there is no place for racism in the heart of God and in the kingdom of God. And if you have racism in your heart, you may not be part of God's kingdom. You've got to check yourself before you wreck yourself. We serve people of all walks of life, of all colors, of all socioeconomic status, because God cares about everybody. If they matter to God, they ought to matter to you. Nineveh was an enemy of God, and God spared them. I just want to tell you, I'm glad that God spares his enemies because I was one of them too. Anybody else in this room? You were far from God, separated from God, and God showed up and He showed out and He brought you into the fold. So while we're waiting to see what God's going to do, Jonah is just sitting there watching this and he's mad. And I want to tell you this for my last little bit of time. He goes up on the hill to watch what God's going to do. Can I just tell you, there's some people who you're full of pride and you want to sit up and look down. But I want you to know that where the down is where God's moving. It ain't up on the hill. He's with the people, bringing them back to repentance. And Jonah's sitting there watching this, hoping that God's not going to spare them. And God does an incredible thing. He takes, and it says, I don't have time to read it, that God arranged for a plant to cover Jonah. Even with the jacked up heart that Jonah has, God still has mercy for Jonah. In the heat of the day, God arranges for a plant to cover his sin, to cover his shame, to cover his hatred. But you know what he does next? The next day, God arranges for a worm to eat the plant. Be careful, Life Springs Church, on what side of God's you are. He'll give you a chance to repent, but then he can take it away if you don't listen. Just like with Jonah. And Jonah gets mad about it. He gets so upset that here's what it says in verse 10. After Jonah has been mad, he says, just kill me. And here's what the Lord says, verse 10. You feel sorry about the plant, though you did nothing to put it there. It came quickly and died quickly. In other words, God's saying, don't get it twisted. I'm in charge, not you. I'm the one who holds mercy, not you. I do what I want, and you can't do nothing about it. He says, verse 11, but Nineveh has more than 120,000 people, read that next part, 1, 2, 3, living in spiritual darkness, not to mention all the animals. Shouldn't I feel sorry for such a great city? I want to stop there. Because I don't know if you know this, you may not, but that's the last verse of Jonah, the book of Jonah. God asks a question and doesn't even give Jonah a chance to answer it. You know why I think he does that? Because I think God is transcending time. And this question ain't just for Jonah. This question is for you and it's for me. What God is saying to Life Springs Church, what God is saying to you, what God is saying to those watching online, shouldn't I feel sorry for such a great city? Shouldn't I feel sorry for Sanford? Shouldn't I feel sorry for Western Harnett? Shouldn't I feel sorry for North Carolina? Shouldn't I feel sorry for the United States? I know you don't like what's going on, but God says, shouldn't I feel sorry? We've got to feel sorry. Have compassion. Have mercy on those in need. I told you the story about those track runners. When I was in eighth grade, we lined up for the race, and I told you, I'm a big guy. I've always been a big guy, and I'm standing there, and what they tell you to do is have one foot in front of the other and put your hand behind you to get the baton, and as soon as it hits your hand, you start to run. But what happens is you're running while they're trying to catch up with you, right? In that moment, the hardest part of the relay is not dropping the baton. And I'm afraid there's some Christians in this room that if you would be honest, when I say to you, we've got to show mercy for our city, we've got to show compassion, we've got to preach repentance and not judgment, you'll miss the baton and drop it on the ground. So I get to running. And I'm running fast. And I thought these guys were going to laugh at me because they're fast and I'm not. But you know what they did? They kept right behind me. Come on, Carter. You can do it, Carter. Don't give up, Carter. You've got this, Carter. And they kept on with me till the end of the race. Can I just tell you, that's what God is saying to you. Come on, Life Springs. Let's go, Sanford. We can do this. Don't give up. I got a word for the people. You've got to hold the baton. How many understand this message? Hold your hands good high. We've got people to reach, guys. We've got North Carolina to reach. We've got to live sent. It begins with me. It begins with you. There's people watching online right now. Maybe you're incarcerated. and you feel judged, can I just tell you, Life Springs Church, we don't judge you. We love you. Your best days are ahead of you and not behind you. Keep going. You can do it. There's some of you watching online right now that you've been checking out Life Springs from a distance. You're afraid to come into the doors, that someone might judge you. But let me just tell you, if they do, you bring them to me. We'll take them out because we care about you. There's people in this room today who you're scared to sign up. You're scared to step up into leadership. But I'm here to tell you, if God called you to it, don't be afraid. He's going to bless you. He's going to use you. It's time to take the baton and keep going. How many understand this message? I want to see the best for you. So if you would, maybe just close your eyes. Maybe if we would, we're going to close this service. Would you stand where you are? I feel like there's two kinds of people, at least, in this room. There's some of you here who you came to church, and if you're honest with yourself, you're not in the family of God. You're Nineveh. You're separate from them. But I just want to tell you, He's got room for you and His family. There's some of you who, when I talked about the city and how God flipped the script on Jonah and showed the hatred in his own heart, maybe you've got some areas that you need to repent from too. Pride, arrogance, anger, prejudice, racism. Something has been blocking what God wants to do through you. And if you're here and you would say, Jonathan, I want to give my life to God. I want to become a Christian. I want my life to matter. If that's you, would you raise your hand so I could pray for you? Yeah. I see one, two hands. Come on, let's just give God three hands. Let's give God praise for three hands raised. Hallelujah. In fact, let's just all say this prayer. We don't want to embarrass anyone here. We don't judge. We love. Let this family right here, let's all say this prayer together and say, God, forgive me of my sins. Make me a new creation and help me to live like your son. If you said that prayer, welcome to the family of God. The second group of people who I think might would be in this room today, chapter 4 just resonated with you. Jonah on the hill, mad at God. And maybe you just don't have a lot of mercy in your heart for people who do things wrong. I get it. I've been there. It was me too. But you want to change that. You want to be in God's shade and not the worm eating the blessings of God in your life. If you're here, would you raise your hand so I can pray for you? That you want God to give you a heart of mercy for your city. Yeah, I see your hands. Yeah. Yeah. Father, thank you. I pray that this message would resonate deep in our souls. We've got work to do. As long as you tarry, we've got people to bring into the family of God. I pray that we would have a hunger for our city, a hunger for our family, a hunger for our community, a hunger for our workplace, God. Let us see more and more souls go to heaven and fewer in hell because we love you and we need you. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Hey, we're going to finish this service with singing a song and open up this altar. I'm going to invite our altar workers to get in position. And maybe you're here today and you want to pray about something from the message, or maybe it's something totally different that's going on in your life. That's what they're here for. Or maybe you don't want to be bothered, but you just want to come to the altar. And I'm going to invite you to do that here in just a second. And for some of you, we're doing a thing. You see it on both of my sides. There's these walls with colors of paper. We're doing a thing where we're writing down prayers of repentance, things we're sorry to God for. Maybe you need to write some down after this message. This is a time for you to connect with God to get it right before we dismiss. So as we sing this song, come on, I want to invite my more bold folks. Let's get started. Let's sing this song to God as we watch Him move in our lives.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine, and He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time.
God's saying, I'm right there with you.
Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood, and what He did for me on Calvary is more than enough.
Everything He's done for you is to bless
so
you.
So I trust in God, my Savior, the one.
Come on, let's sing it out to Him. He's never failed.
He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Perfect submission.
Time for us to get ready.
And all is at rest.
He's calling you to something big.
And I know the author of tomorrow is under my step.
God's plan is the perfect one anyway. Just trust in Him. Believe in Him. Cry out to Him. Listen to Him. Trust Him.
Praise Him, my risen King and Savior. All the day long.
This is why you do it.
So I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail.
It's not going to be easy, but He's going to be with
fail.
You. He doesn't fail, so you're going to win.
So I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
Amen. Can we give God some praise in the house? What a powerful word from Pastor Jonathan. We're going to close in prayer in just a second. But, you know, we always do this because you gave kind of stories. And we get to, you know, we get to a lot of times tell the story because you gave. But, you know, we had mentioned last week how we had around 20 of our youth, our high schoolers went to an encounter trip in Dunn, and how they just... they got on fire and they came back, and last night they just had revival at youth, and how exciting it was. So instead of me telling you, we're going to take a couple of minutes and we're going to let them tell you, Pastor Chris and them. So if you would, turn your attention to the screen for a couple of minutes.
Hey everybody, this is Pastor Chris here, the Next Gen Pastor here at Life Springs Church. And I want to talk to you about what the students encountered at Encounter this past weekend. We saw 10 salvations and 6 recommitments. Words can't describe what went on this weekend, but let's check out and see what they had to say about it.
Hi, I'm Malik, and over this weekend, God has helped me realize my true potential of what I could possibly do in life, and has fixed a lot of problems I have had.
Hi, I'm Mariah. Encounter gave me not only a stronger bond with my friends, but a really strong bond with Jesus, and it helped me grow my faith and realize that you should always trust in God.
Hi, I'm Michael, and what Encounter has done for me this weekend was show me how God moves through people. He relieved a bunch of my stress and anxiety and everything else that I have going on in life, and it made me feel real light.
My name is Jaquela. A way that God moved in my life during the encounter was worship and helped me with some of my problems I deal with at home.
My name is Ray, and God changed my life during encounter by showing me the power of worship and how it can change you and how important it is to worship.
Hey, I'm Kendall. And through Encounter this weekend, God taught me that not only does He see us and love us, but He knows what is best for us.
The biggest reason I love God is because He sent His Son to die on the cross for us. And if it wasn't for Him, I possibly wouldn't be here.
I love Jesus because He's the one constant in my life when everything else is going crazy.
I love God because He helps us and He understands us and He's always there for us.
I love Jesus because He helped me become a better person and teach me how to do right from wrong.
I love Jesus because He forgave me even though I'm not worthy of His forgiveness.
I love Jesus because He provides for us even when we don't think He's there.
The reason why I love God is because I watched a bunch of people this weekend get saved. And in the world that we live in now, faith in through or living through Him is the most important.
I love God because He got me through a lot of hard times and got me through a lot of people that didn't really care.
I love Jesus because I see Him move in things like this. I've been going to this place for years now, and I just love seeing Him move, and I know that He loves me too.
Amen. Thank y'all for giving. If you're new to Life Springs Church, do not give. We didn't invite you here to take your money. Church family, it's going to be your opportunity to give on the way out. The black boxes mounted on the walls. You can go to lifesprings.online, or you can download the app, the Life Springs Church Center app, and give there as well. Let's pray. Father, we praise You and we thank You, God, for Your word tonight. We thank You, God, for communion. We thank You, God, for the opportunity to worship You. And now we thank You that we get to give. We don't have to, we get to. And Father, give us more opportunities, like sending our youth to retreats like Encounter and changing their lives and bringing that fire back here to let it spread, not only here at Life Springs Church, but in their schools and with their friends. Give us more opportunities. Father, we love You and we praise You and we give You the glory, and we ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Can we praise Him again as we leave? Y'all have a good weekend.